Hello and welcome to Chemistry Solutions. This tutorial is on ionic compounds. Ions are formed when a neutral atom either gains or loses electrons. If a neutral atom loses electrons, it loses negative charged and becomes a positively charged ion, which we call a cation. Likewise, if a neutral atom gains electrons, it's gaining negative charge and becomes a negatively charged ion, which we call an anion. There are also polyatomic ions, which is when a molecule has a net overall charge. And for the most part, polyatomic ions must be memorized. But for single atoms, we can generally predict what sort of ions they will form. And how can we do that? We can predict what ions certain atoms will form by using a periodic table. And in general, most atoms will gain or lose electrons in order to have the same number of electrons as the noble gas closest to them. When looking at your periodic table, remember that the noble gases are in this last column on the right. And so if most atoms will gain or lose electrons in order to have the same number of electrons as the noble gas closest to them, then we know that all of the elements in this first row of the periodic table will want to lose one electron and will form ions with a positive one charge. For example, looking here at sodium, a neutral sodium has 11 protons and 11 electrons, as designated by its atomic number. If sodium loses one electron, it will then have 10 electrons, which is the same as the noble gas neon. And you always want to look at the closest noble gas. So for example, neon is a closer noble gas to sodium than argon would be. Likewise, atoms in the second column of your periodic table will want to lose two electrons. And remember, because we're losing negative charge, we're forming more positive ions. As we move over to the right side of the periodic table, we know that atoms in the seventh group will want to gain electrons in order to have the same number of electrons as the noble gas closest to them. So for example, if you look at fluorine, a neutral fluorine atom will have 9 protons and 9 electrons. If fluorine gains one electron, it will have 10 electrons, which is the same as the noble gas closest to it, which would be neon. And following our trend, atoms in the sixth group will generally form ions with a negative 2 charge. These rules generally hold true for the four columns that I've shown you. Usually, atoms in the fifth group will form ions with a negative 3 charge, and atoms in the third group will form ions with a positive 3 charge. Now there's a whole bunch of metals here in the middle, and we typically can't make any assumption about these. These are known as transition metals, and often they can form ions with different charges. An ionic compound is a compound formed from a cation and an anion, so a positively charged ion and a negatively charged ion. Typically, that's a metal and a nonmetal. Although you can see some exceptions where you have a polyatomic cation, which is also a nonmetal, combining with a nonmetal anion, and you can have an ionic compound that is two nonmetals. For ionic compounds, only empirical formulas may be written. And an empirical formula is a formula written in the simplest ratio of atoms. Generally, you can predict the empirical formula of an ionic compound. The overall charge of the compound must be neutral, so the total positive charge from the cation must equal the total negative charge from the anion. So if the charges on the ions are known, or you can predict the charges by looking at the periodic table, you can predict the empirical formula of an ionic compound formed from those ions. And this is typically as easy as writing the charge on one ion, which is written as a superscript, as the subscript for the other ion. If you look at this example, we have sodium, which forms ions that have a positive 1 charge, and sulfur, which forms ions that have a negative 2 charge. And so you just need to flip-flop those superscripts and write them as subscripts. So the correct ionic formula for the ionic compound made from sodium and sulfur would be Na2S. And remember, if the subscript on an atom is 1, we don't typically write that 1 in the formula. Let's try predicting the empirical formulas for the ionic compounds composed of the following atoms below. If we're forming an ionic compound from calcium and bromine, We know that calcium forms ions with a positive 2 charge. And we can predict this because calcium is in the second column on our periodic table. Bromine forms ions with a negative 1 charge. And we can predict that because we know bromine is in the 7th column on our periodic table. So if calcium and bromine combine to form an ionic compound, the empirical formula of that compound will be CaBr2. Let's look at magnesium and nitrogen. Again, we can predict the charges on the ions formed from these atoms by using our periodic table. Magnesium will form an ion with a positive 2 charge, and nitrogen will form an ion with a negative 3 charge. If we flip-flop our superscripts, the formula for the ionic compound composed of magnesium and nitrogen will be Mg3N2. You can double-check by making sure that the total positive and total negative charges cancel each other out. So if we have 3 magnesium ions, and they all have a charge of plus 2, we know that the total positive charge will be plus 6. If we have 2 nitrogen ions, and the charge on each nitrogen ion is minus 3, we know that we have a total negative charge of minus 6. And because the addition of the positive and negative charges is 0, we know our compound is neutral, with no net charge. Aluminum forms ions with a charge of plus 3, and sulfur forms ions with a charge of minus 2, so the empirical formula for aluminum sulfide is Al2S3, and potassium forms ions with a charge of plus 1, while chlorine forms ions with a charge of minus 1, so the formula for potassium chloride is KCl. Thanks for watching. We hope you enjoyed this Chemistry Solutions tutorial.